about. Let's talk to Dr. Andrew Foxall, who's director of the Russia and Eurasia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society, and joins us now. Good morning to you.
Good morning, Julia.
Good morning. Now, this isn't just about three boats and a particular straits, is it? This is more about sort of rather more bigger geopolitical issues. Why do you believe that Russia has acted in this way?
So you're quite right. You know, it's important both at the micro level, but also at the macro level as well. At the micro level, in terms of, you know, as you mentioned, these three boats, it's been obvious for a number of months that tension has been building between Ukraine and Russia over the Kerch Strait and the Sea of Azov. Sunday was a major escalation in that sense, but Russia has been inspecting Ukrainian vessels both entering and leaving Ukrainian ports for a number of months, which is contrary to a 2003 treaty that Ukraine and Russia signed, which recognizes both the Kerch Strait and the Sea of Azov as being shared territorial waters. Now, Russia has been militarizing the Sea of Azov since 2015. That was the year that it built this bridge over the Kerch Strait. Russia has moved some of its naval capabilities from the Caspian Sea to the Sea of Azov, to the point where it largely now has the ability to blockade all of Ukraine's ports. And Ukraine's ports are obviously important for its economy, as around a quarter of its exports are by sea. And that would obviously, should a blockade happen, that would risk significant economic damage for Ukraine. But you're also quite right in what you say about the broader context here. I mean, this is a reminder, really, that that Russia's war with Ukraine and Russia's war on Ukraine really has never stopped. You know, we're coming up in February and March, we'll be coming up to the five-year anniversary of the annexation of Crimea. In March, we'll be coming up to the five-year anniversary of Russia's integration of Crimea into the Russian Federation, and the five-year anniversary of the invasion of eastern Ukraine. Now, whilst it's true to say that the intensity of the conflict is now much lower than it was, there are still skirmishes on a daily basis along the line of contacts between Ukraine and Luhansk and Donetsk.
Well, this is, as you know, Russia has claimed the waters off Crimea since it seized the peninsula from Ukraine back in 2014. And this is the issue, isn't it? This has always been, we're talking to Sir Andrew Wood, the former British ambassador to Russia yesterday. This has always been in Russia's view. This is, you know, this is part of their, as far as they're concerned, the Russian Federation. This is part of their sphere of influence at the very least. And it's their business what happens. They've always been unhappy about Ukraine being independent, and certainly with Ukraine's moves many, you know, some years back to try sort of move towards, you know, leaning towards the West. The reality is, though, is anyone in the West going to actually act in Ukraine's defence? Everyone's, you know, basically saying calm down, calm down. But realistically, is NATO or United Nations, is anyone going to act to ensure that Russia does back off?
Well, I think what's interesting in the Western responses that we've seen thus far is that most of the responses have called for restraint on both sides, restraint from both Ukraine and restraint from Russia. I would argue that that's a mistake. It seems perfectly clear that there's no equivalence of responsibility in relation to the events on Sunday. In spite of what the Kremlin might say, this was quite clearly an act of unprovoked Russian aggression, just like Russia's annexation of Crimea and just like Russia's invasion of eastern Ukraine. But in terms of what might happen next from the international community, additional sanctions might be brought by the European Union. I mean, that seems doubtful at the moment, given everything else that the European Union is sort of grappling with and dealing with. NATO, again, a strongly worded response, but not much else, and so to the United Nations Security Council. I think the international community is largely working on the basis that it's not really in either President Poroshenko or President Putin's interests for this, again, serious incident to break out into all out war. But nevertheless, when a game of brinkmanship is taking place, clearly accidents are possible.
Well, indeed, and the accusations from the Russians are that actually that President Poroshenko, he's facing elections, that he's just trying to do this to boost his own position. Is there anything in that?
Well, it's true that there are presidential elections in Ukraine scheduled for March 31st and Petro Poroshenko has indicated that he's going to run. His election campaign thus far has been built on a strong military in defending Ukraine, and this escalation in a sense tests and undermines that claim and the resolve that he claims Ukraine now has. Martial law, which as you mentioned earlier has now been introduced, does allow the president to suspend elections. There's no indication that the martial law will be extended beyond the 30 days and in that way would impact on the presidential elections. But it's also true to say that on current polling, President Poroshenko looks likely to lose the presidential election.
Very interesting. Thank you very much indeed for that analysis, Dr. Andrew Foxall, Director of the Russia and Eurasia Studies Center at the Henry Jackson Society. For keeping watching briefly.